Macmillan Audio presents Maiden Voyages by Siân Evans, read for you by Jilly.
Prologue. Smart and snug in heather-toned tweeds, a British-born lady passenger of middle years and independent means is settled in a teak steamer chair on the promenade deck of an ocean liner, heading west across the Atlantic. There is a whiff of healthy ozone from the sea, and fellow travellers taking the air variously saunter or speed past, competing for laps, heading to the gym, or to the swimming pool. The attentive deck steward proffers a steaming mug of bouillon. So effective against seasickness, but in order to be sure, she'll take another Mother Sills tablet. Just as that kind stewardess had predicted, the heaving swell of the Atlantic Ocean once they passed Ireland had proved to be a little too lively for comfort. Yesterday had crawled by in a disorientating low-lit blur. She had spent hours wedged into her bunk, lying prone, wishing for death, while keeping an eye on the discreetly positioned vase de nuit, just in case. But this morning she had woken with the appetite of a bootle-born coal stoker. She had rung the bell, twice for the stewardess. A single ring would summon the steward, which would breach etiquette, and requested a fully laden breakfast tray of kippers, tea and toast. Her equilibrium has now been restored in every sense. Standing with her feet at the 10-2 ballet position for maximum stability, her knees slightly bent, as the stewardess tactfully suggested, also seems to help. Bathed, dressed and ready to face the world, our heroine has ventured out onto the covered deck and secured a reclining chair. Her thoughts turn to her fellow passengers. She must trawl through the alphabetically arranged list of first-class passengers' names left prominently in her cabin to see if she knows anyone else on board or can spot anyone she might like to meet. Society is superior to variety, and she is hoping to make the acquaintance of the elite also travelling in first class. In particular, she is looking out for a pleasant, well-heeled bachelor, as there is rather a dearth of those at home, just a few years after the end of the Great War. Perhaps she'll do better in America, land of opportunity. Opportunities abound for sociable, single, wealthy transatlantic female passengers. According to the daily newspaper, printed every night on board, there is a tea dance this afternoon, with music provided by the pianist, and after dinner a concert, followed by dancing to the ship's orchestra. Daytime visits to the swimming pool with tutoring from the female coach, the Turkish baths where she is pampered by the masseurs, and restorative sessions with the lady hairdresser promote a sense of well-being. In fact, the whole vessel seems to have been deliberately designed to appeal to lady travellers of all stripes. Reassuringly, the grand public rooms recall the better sort of country house. Every room is decked out in a different historical style, as though it had grown gradually over the centuries, with each generation adding another wing according to the fashion of the day. Odd, when you think about it, because this enormous ship was constructed by swarms of men in cloth caps, riveting together great steel plates in somewhere industrial, like Clydebank. With its Palladian-style lounge and Carolean smoking room, the ship's interior recalls the smart new hotels now springing up in European and American capitals. No wonder some wag referred to this ship as the Ritzonia. Meanwhile, the stewardess makes final checks of the staterooms of her ladies before the captain's daily inspection at 11 a.m. Scrupulously clean and neat in her grey uniform, white cap and apron, she is a company widow whose husband died when the Lusitania was torpedoed in 1915. To provide for her two small children, following the armistice, she went to sea as a floating chambermaid, leaving the boys to be brought up by their maternal grandmother. Every fortnight, they have a scant 48 hours together when her ship docks in Southampton, her home port. She brings them American cigarette cards for their collection and picture postcards of the Statue of Liberty. Her wages are supplemented by the tips she often receives from grateful passengers. She has been on duty since 6:30 a.m. and will fall into her bunk in the tiny windowless cabin she shares with another stewardess around 10 p.m. with throbbing feet. In the second-class smoking room, concentration is fierce as four American buyers play bridge. Three of them are middle-aged women. It is a career that suits entrepreneurial types with a head for commerce. Each has commissions from competing stateside department stores or specialist boutiques, selecting European garments and accessories for the American market. They are returning from the summer shows at the Paris fashion houses with their precious purchases, samples and order books safely stowed in their cabins. Buying is a competitive business, and economic espionage is rife, so each of them will type up their orders themselves rather than booking the ship's stenographer to do the work for them. One of the unspoken reasons for these bridge marathons is so that they all know where their rivals are during waking hours. The ship's stenographer is busy anyway, having been engaged by an eminent lady writer to take dictation in her cabin. For any young woman with an outgoing personality, shorthand and a portable typewriter provide a ticket to travel the world in these boom years just after the Great War. Today's client is a well-known British authority on theosophy and has been invited on a lecture tour of America. While her writings may be spiritual in tone, she is a canny businesswoman with an eye to the benefits of meeting her public. And, as one of her contemporaries, P.G. Woodhouse, observed, she was halfway across the Atlantic with a complete itinerary booked before 90% of the poets and philosophers had finished sorting out their clean collars and getting their photographs taken for the passport. In another cabin, further along the second-class corridor, an apparently respectable husband and wife are discussing their tactics for compromising a wealthy Frenchman who is travelling alone. The couple are frequent transatlantic travellers because they are professional blackmailers. On this voyage, the wife has piqued their target's interest by convincingly playing the role of a bored and neglected beauty. She has hinted that her complacent and lacklustre husband prefers to spend his nights afloat playing cards in the bar and that she is lonely and available for a nocturnal dalliance. Tonight will provide an opportunity to reel him in. But first they need to divine his home address and the name of his wife. When, inevitably, the apparently outraged husband catches them in flagrante delicto, he will threaten to inform the Frenchman's wife unless the would-be philanderer agrees to pay compensation. Down near the waterline, in third class, professional chaperones provide support and protection for unaccompanied women and children from far-flung parts of Europe. This morning the chaperone is organising hot seawater baths for some of her reluctant charges, a welcome opportunity for them to bathe in privacy and to wash their clothes. All the women travelling in third class are economic migrants, and the luckier ones are making the voyage with their families, neighbours or friends. Some already have a stepping stone, relatives who can help them get established on the new continent. The teenage daughter of a crofter from the Scottish island of Lewis, with older sisters already settled in New York, is eminently eligible for a visa to work as a domestic servant. Two brothers and a sister have secured employment on a farm in rural Michigan. Their wages will eventually enable their hard-pressed family back home to escape the economic ruin of 1920s Germany. On this summer morning, The oil-fired ocean liner is heading west at an impressive rate, covering 500 miles a day, steaming from the old world to the new. These 2,500 souls from all over Europe, passengers of many classes, creeds and countries, and the ship's company, all the crew and staff, male and female, are under the omnipotent command of the captain while they are underway. Though it is one of the largest man-made moving objects on the planet, the liner is dwarfed by the ocean and is totally alone on a vast and open sea. Anyone standing high enough on the very top deck and rotating 360 degrees would see nothing more than a slightly curving panorama of completely empty horizon. A daunting prospect for the agoraphobic. But for the women on board the ocean liner, the great ship offers hope, opportunity, romance. Whether they are travelling for leisure or pleasure, by virtue of their celebrity or to preserve their anonymity, as matrons, migrants or millionairesses, as passengers or staff, the journey they will undertake will change their lives forever. Introduction. Cresting the Waves. Remarkable as it seems nowadays, until the middle of the 20th century, the only practical way for civilians to cross the Atlantic was by embarking on some sort of ship. 3,000 miles of open ocean could not be traversed except by sailing, until technological and engineering advances made long-haul flights first possible, then comfortable and affordable for paying customers in the 1950s. Consequently, until the middle of the 20th century, ocean liners were the only viable form of transport for international travellers between the landmasses of America and Europe. For more than a century before flying replaced sea travel, mid-Victorian entrepreneurs, engineers, designers and shipbuilders collaborated to create technologically advanced great ships, which were built to sail the Atlantic. A daunting stretch of water, prone to sudden storms, thick fogs and occasional icebergs. The ships were primarily designed to carry raw materials, saleable commodities and produce, and important communications such as mail on a regular and reliable basis. They were operated for the maximum profit of the privately owned shipping companies who competed for the most lucrative routes between the major ports of Europe and those of the American Eastern Seaboard. And as a sideline, they also transported people who were prepared to face lengthy, uncomfortable, and often dangerous journeys. Each ship had to be entirely self-sufficient while at sea, carrying its own provisions, including fuel, food and fresh water, labour, tools and expertise, as it would be out of sight of land and far from any form of assistance for weeks on end. In addition, the vessel had to be resilient enough to withstand the rough seas and adverse conditions to be found in the North Atlantic. Engineering innovations, such as the steam engine and steel hull, enabled the construction of ever larger and faster ships, ramping up competition between world powers of the time, especially between Great Britain and Germany. Each seagoing nation competed to advance the interests of its own mercantile fleet, meeting the astonishing demand for transatlantic travel. In January 1842, Charles Dickens sailed from Liverpool to Boston on RMS Britannia with his wife Kate and her maid. He was impressed by the ship's power and speed, revolutionary for the time, but was appalled by his cabin, which was utterly impracticable, thoroughly hopeless and profoundly preposterous too. Nothing smaller for sleeping in was ever made except coffins, he wrote lugubriously. Dickens kept a vivid account of their appalling 18-day journey, describing the ever-present seasickness, the tumultuous roughness of the sea, the perpetual discomfort of being cold and wet, the difficulty of dispensing remedial teaspoons of brandy as the ship heaved and plunged, and the sorry plight of the lone cow, brought along to provide fresh milk during the passage, lowing piteously in her stall up on deck. The Britannia was badly damaged by ferocious storms, one of the lifeboats was smashed to matchwood by a freak wave, and Dickens doggedly and soggily played cards hour after hour with the ship's doctor for 15 days. Once the worst of his nausea had receded, Dickens mentions, almost in passing, that
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.